Welcome to the Get Uncomfortable podcast show, video podcast show with Stacy A. Cross, there's no E in my name, and
Joe McCabe.
Joe McCabe, and we're here live at the REMAX office, REMAX Experts, live in Manayunk, Philadelphia. Stop in, stop by, say hi, but come to do some business, man. We're looking for realtors, loan officers.
Everybody.
We're looking for everybody. Anybody that wants to do something, this is the best place to do it at and to grow. In fact, today, this morning, we went out and had a listing appointment together.
We did.
And we saw some crazy stuff down there in that area. But one thing that struck my attention is that a wholesaler got in touch with our client first and left a bad taste. In a person's
mind.
Gave realtors a bad name. Themselves gave wholesalers a bad name. Well, wholesalers is very hard to come up from that name that they
have. And an entire real estate company that's pretty large in the city. So we won't bring that name up.
Yeah, but
they don't have a good name now.
Well, you know what? Thank you so much, wholesalers, for failing that we could be... It's not even hard work for us anymore. Today's going to be an awesome show. We attempted to do it another time, but we said, okay, we're going to split it up into segments so it's easier to follow, easier to understand, and man, I just can't wait to get into it. So this one is for specifically for those that are looking to invest.
Yeah, those looking to invest and maybe possibly just inspire you to do something bigger that maybe you wouldn't have done before just because now you can see it can be done.
Right. So you didn't, we're talking about your deal specifically, a deal that you had in Pittsburgh that recently closed after a year and a half.
Exactly.
So the patience, the hustle, the longevity, I mean,
what it takes, the team you need in place, you know, the capital you need, that type of thing. We're going to go through all that today.
Yeah. So let's do it and see if we can get any information. Guys, get your notepads, get your pens, pencils out, because this one's going to, you're going to get something away from this that'll help you if you're looking to start investing in real estate. Why not just go for it all the way, like go big, right?
Is that what you might as well go big. I mean, the only limiting belief is the one that you're giving yourself.
Mm.
This can totally be done. You're stopping yourself from doing it for whatever the reason.
Yeah.
So for the same amount of money that you could take to buy one duplex, you could buy 70.
Right. But no one says that, though.
No one tells you that.
They said to, you know, go after you go to the seminar, really what's being said is, you know, you start with that one and then maybe in 10 years you can build your portfolio.
Yeah.
You actually went out and got somebody's portfolio, man. You let them do the hard work.
Let them do the hard work. You know, let them do the hard work.
Yeah.
One thing that I always heard, well, I experienced from having two duplexes were my first two properties.
Yeah.
And then that was a mess. I mean, you lose one tenant and you have trouble paying the bills or, you know, whatever it
is. That's true.
And the income of four units just is not worth it to me.
Right.
So what I started to hear from people like Grant Cardone and all these other property investors was 16 units and more is where they like to be.
Yeah.
So I was like, well, 16 doesn't sound like a lot either. So I want 100. So I shot for 100. I ended up with 70 properties, just under 100 units.
Right. So I guess that holds true. Like if you make your goal bigger than just massive.
Yeah. And
even if you're
willing to put in the work.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, prior to the year and a half that the deal went on, there's another 4 months before that of me just submitting hundreds and hundreds of letters of intent to people all over the country asking them, hey, basically, I don't have any money to buy these properties. Mm-hmm. I want you to give them to me. And I'll refinance them later.
Yeah, yeah. So that's the first thing. I mean, letters of intent sent out. And you mentioned that there's a program that helps you out. There's a software online that helps you out. All right, let's get into it. What's the first part of a deal? When you're coming in, new investor, you don't know anything. Let's go back to a year and a half ago where it's kind of like you don't know a damn thing. You're coming up, you're pumped up, you're like, let me do this.
Yeah. So, I mean, the way I kind of got started in all of this was one of my first listings was 91 properties with Bob Mazur down in Mount Airy. And at one point, he owned thousands of units, and I had sold these over and over and over again to different investors, but the deal never panned out for whatever reason, millions of reasons. So one day I was like, you know what? Why can't I buy these properties?
Mm.
So I went to Bob and I said, Bob, because people started bringing up seller financing. And at the time I was green. I didn't know anything about that. So I'm like, well, if they only want like 30% seller financing, why can't I get like 100%? The properties have enough equity. I could refinance them later.
Mm-hmm.
And cash out Bob. He gets the money he wants and I get 91 properties.
Right.
It'll be great. So I get him to agree to that after like 6 months, and that deal falls apart. You know, so it was just, he's too concerned.
Yeah. So let me ask you a question, though. What type of sellers would be okay with doing 100% seller's financing?
Who I found to be the people that are okay with that, like, this would never work in Philly.
Okay.
This could work in, like, Chester County. This worked out in Pittsburgh, Allegheny County. Yeah. Places where the market is hot. Places where the market is not so hot.
Okay.
You know, it's a rental market, but maybe people out there are preferring, you know, multifamily units. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the people that I've purchased from were blue collar guys who kind of build up a portfolio one property at a time.
Got it. They did the hard work.
Self-managed. Yep. They did all the hard work.
Yep.
And now they got to sell, but there's not a huge market for single family portfolios.
Gotcha.
So it took me going out there and explaining this process. They were going to sell them one by one,
right,
or just take a huge hit to get rid of them. And I made this proposal, got the listing agent on board with it to understand it, mm-hmm, you know, got their attorneys involved in understanding of the deal, and we put a lot of safeguards in place so everyone was comfortable.
Got it.
So the blue collar places in a market that's not so hot but stable.
Yeah.
In a high rental market.
Mm-hmm.
That's where this can be done.
Yeah, so they're not looking for your average couple first time home buyers to purchase these properties.
It's definitely not. These are rentals.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
These are straight rentals.
Got it. So that's the first clue, guys, ladies and gentlemen, is like, what type of market are you going into? He just said it clear as day, because 100% seller's finance works in different markets.
Sure.
And it works in a rental market.
Yeah, like Indiana. Okay. I always get hits from people in Indiana.
So like
Ohio.
Like the blue collar kind of places, you know, like
where it's rental market dominated.
Okay.
That's where you'll
gotcha.
Get. And then Philly, there's just way too many cash buyers here now. So I can't compete with a cash buyer with this structure.
Right. So you think that a cash buyer could come in and kind of tear up that deal in 100% seller's financing if they even go way below market value?
In a second.
They will knock it out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, because I still got them undervalued.
Yeah.
It's just that there were no buyers for this portfolio out there.
Got it. And what single family your aim? Like, you went in there?
Well, I only really knew single family.
Mm.
And then a lot of the multifamily and commercial stuff, that has a much lower loan to value when you go to refinance. And we'll get into that. But the loan to value is where you run into issues with this type of deal. So if there's not enough equity in the property, you may be able to obtain financing for 70% of the loan to value. Mm-hmm. But what if that doesn't pay off the seller financed portion?
At the end.
What then?
Yeah.
You know, there's some things you can do and some safeguards you can put in place in the contract so that you don't lose the deal at that point. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did.
Nice. Nice. So, okay, we're going to start off with you. So you're working with Bob.
Yeah, working with Bob.
91 properties.
I sell it over and over and over again.
Yeah,
and
he's too conservative. It's not going to work.
He's too conservative.
Yeah.
And so I finally pitch it to him, and I was amazed because he agrees to my structure. And, you know, in this case, I'm not putting any cash out of pocket. I'm not even paying for appraisals, and I'm making a 3% commission.
Yeah.
Money off the title policy, money off the mortgage refinance. So I went to Bob. I showed him what we could do. I was like, the properties are yours. You're still going to continue to manage them. Deeds are in escrow. I'm just going to refinance them and pay you a mortgage payment.
Mm.
So I get him to kind of agree to that. And then he just got scared of it like halfway.
It's too new. It's creative.
It's too new. Yeah. And then he wanted to renovate them.
Yeah.
There was more money for him, and he has the capital to go out and just renovate all 91 properties.
Mm.
So that was a better choice for him.
Right. And then get it at a higher selling point.
Yeah. Okay. But what that did for me was it opened up my eyes to, hey, all these guys are coming to buy these properties. I could do it too with $0.
Mm.
And that's what I did. But it wasn't going to happen here. It wasn't going
to
happen in Philly.
Yeah. So you had to broaden your horizons, get uncomfortable a bit, and decide to go to Pittsburgh. But you didn't care where.
No, I didn't care. And a lot of the people, like Bob's generation, and like a lot of the guys I knew in real estate in Northeast Philly, are like, they made a lot of mistakes. And one of the biggest mistakes Bob made was he continued to self-manage. That's what he told me. He could never grow past that because he self-managed. So, you know, when people would also tell me, hey, well, don't buy in another state, you know, buy bricks close to your house.
Yeah.
Some saying like that. And I didn't care. You know, like, that didn't make a difference to me because I knew I wasn't going to self-manage. Someone who's afraid to buy in another state, I think that they're thinking too small and they want to have control.
Mm.
But sometimes having that much control is a bad thing.
Yeah.
And you can't focus on other things.
So it's the landlord mindset where you want to manage the property, fix the toilets yourself.
Yeah, they're micromanaging everything.
Micromanage.
And that's why, like, that's when you start hearing people, like, even now,
yeah,
to this day, like, I now own 70-some properties, mm-hmm. and the first thing people tell me is, ugh, I would never want to deal with the tenants, the termites.
Yeah. The toilets.
You guys are totally on the wrong page. Yeah. Like, you're an idiot.
Yeah.
You would not want 70 properties because you have to deal with tenants and termites. Well, how about the 20,000 that hits my bank account every month?
They don't worry about that.
It's forget not, that. It's too, that doesn't
yeah,
matter.
Yeah, that doesn't yeah. matter, man.
Uncle Tim with his one house told me that I shouldn't buy more than one unit. Right. I shouldn't invest.
It depends on who they're listening to, too.
Yeah.
Because that
never listen to the wrong people.
Yeah. That's the biggest thing. So you obviously we both listen to Grant Cardone when it comes to certain yeah. things, and you know, 10xing and think bigger.
Yeah.
Or if you would have thought small, you would have had another.
Well, I did. I thought small in the beginning.
Yeah.
I thought small in the beginning.
You had a couple properties, right?
Yeah. And, I bought two really, really bad properties, yeah. Silver and A, and 30 East Silver.
City.
Yep. Just yeah. watch the. Everyone know where that is? Watch the Dr. Oz episode on heroin. Bad
yeah.
street.
Yeah.
And, you know, the tenants never paid, and figures they all don't pay at the same time.
Uh-huh.
They all leave at the same time.
Yeah, something breaks. Were you self-managing that place?
No, those were managed uh-huh. By a property management company in the city who was just afraid to even go down.
There, yeah.
So it was like, I was just so fucked,
yeah.
you know, from the beginning. But the income piece was the worst because, mm-hmm. of course, we had a hard money loan, mm-hmm. actually from Bob Mazur on these.
Ah, nice.
So, like, he helped me buy these, and the future appreciation was great.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't care about that. I wasn't looking to flip these. Yeah. I wanted monthly income for the rest
of
my life.
That's the perfect
and
thing.
And refi every 5 years yeah. to increase the monthly income. And
yeah.
maybe pull out cash and then buy large multifamilies. Mm-hmm. So the goal for me is not to stay in single family.
Mm-hmm.
Although we are looking at, I have a portfolio in Ohio, 292 units. Like, mm-hmm. I'm looking for more single family. Mm-hmm. Because the expenses are lower.
Well, you got your feet wet now, man.
I got my feet wet.
He's like, now I'm going for $292.
I'm a little dangerous now.
Yeah.
A little dangerous
yeah,
now.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have to do it without money now.
Yeah.
So this is one way to do
That's
it
sweet.
When you have $0. Yeah.
Let's get into it. So you're sending over 100 LOIs, which are letter of intent.
Sure.
What program are you using? Guys, write this down here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so deal selection was basically through Crexi, CREXI.com. You can sign up with LinkedIn, Facebook, whatever. Sign up as a broker, sign up as a principal, whatever you want to sign up as. But the thing I like about it, and the greatest thing about commercial real estate or deals like this, is you are able to just submit a letter of intent within like 3 clicks. Purchase price, deposit mm-hmm. amount, how many days, non-binding letter of intent, but mm-hmm. you can just crank these fuckers
mm-hmm.
out.
Mm-hmm.
Another tip. If you have a local Sperry Van Ness office, it's a commercial real estate office, mm-hmm. they dominate the multifamily sector right now. They
mm-hmm.
have taken multifamily real estate in Pittsburgh and doubled the price of it in the past 4 years.
Wow.
They have an incredible prospecting system. I don't know what they do out there. I'm pushing another real estate company.
Yeah, yeah.
They're doing awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look in Crexi, all of the multifamily
really?
Listings are Sperry Van Ness. So
mm-hmm.
you'll see a trend there anyway.
But
you could go right to your local broker in whatever city you're looking and see if they'd be comfortable with that.
Yeah.
So now I have a relationship with someone in Pittsburgh who we close these deals with successfully,
right.
who sends me more and more
nice.
Deals every month.
Nice.
Because he's constantly.
So you're opening up your network, which is opening up your
yeah.
net worth.
And he actually
yep.
is selling two of mine now. I realized I had two properties that had disgusting amounts of equity in them.
Yeah.
Squirrel Hill and mm-hmm. Turtle Creek, good areas in Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
And, we'll probably net like $400,000
yeah.
on those two properties.
Easy.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's sweet.
And the taxes are too high. So,
so you could just chip off this portfolio that you have. You, if you needed some cash flow, some equities real quick,
yeah,
you could just chip them off.
With $400,000, you know, with $400,000, I could easily buy a $2-3 million portfolio now
yeah.
and not have to do all this bullshit
yeah.
and just do a conventional, here's 20%
yep,
down,
yep. Mm-hmm.
or bring in another guy, you know, whatever. I can bring in more investors,
yeah.
but I'm credible. I have
yeah.
the cash. I've done this before.
Yeah. So you got some skin in the game. And when there's skin
yeah.
in the game, you could negotiate a little better. But you did some good negotiation techniques when you sent out these 100 LOIs and then you got to hit back, man. Somebody hit you back.
Yeah,
one
so
of them.
I started getting hits back
yeah.
and then... you know, everyone's impressed with the structure every time.
Really?
Everyone is impressed
yeah.
with the structure. But they're not going to put their clients through that because they can kind of see, wow, this sounds
yeah, let's, could,
this
can
sounds
we,
rough.
Can we do something though, Joe?
Yeah.
I want to actually read one. Do you have an LOI that we could
yeah.
just read real quick so we could get an idea?
And I'll show you how simple
they are. Yeah, of 100% sellers financing, and I think this will help you guys out a lot here. Yeah, we're coming in live from the REMAX office here, REMAX Experts. 4320 Main Street, Philadelphia. It's live out here. People are riding their bikes. Let me get a view so you guys can see. Riding their bikes. They're doing a lot of things out here. All right. We got an LOI?
All right. We got an LOI.
Let's read it.
All right. So let's go through it. So top left-hand corner, that's just my information, is the broker. And then the company that has it listed. Mm-hmm. Kind of looks like a standard, like a letter. Like you wrote someone a letter.
You can turn it around. You can see it right here. Done. Yeah. See that right there? Oh, man.
So that's the top part. So basically, it's just going through, and it's very simple. It says, hey, this is a non-binding letter of intent, 24 units. You know, if we agree, we'll create a purchase sale agreement and send it out. Commercial, you hear PSA instead of AOS.
Got it. Okay.
Just another distinction. You'll hear. So the property was 24 single-family homes out in Winston-Salem. Here's the other thing. Sometimes I don't even know where I don't even know where these are. And I don't really care because they're cash flowing. So I usually just look and I go, okay, what's the net operating income? Could I live with that? Mm-hmm. Cool. And then is the cap rate over 8%?
Okay.
I don't know why. I just like 8. Okay. I'm not. Carl does the numbers. Carl's one of my partners. Mm-hmm. He's a cop in Philly. Carl does all the numbers. Yeah. So, but I just know what the initial numbers are. And as long as it's making a profit after the mortgage, I'm happy because I'm 100% leveraging it. That's my intention.
Nice.
So I don't care.
Nice.
Purchase price is this one was $1.8 million with $5,000 deposit. Talks about due diligence. Actually, on Pittsburgh, we're going to get there, but on Pittsburgh, I put zero deposit for any of these properties. I put literally nothing out of pocket.
So this is after you put the LOI that says that you were going to put five.
Yeah, later, when we actually on Pittsburgh, I probably put zero.
Oh, shit.
It depends. The only reason five is in here is because I had to. Some brokers say minimum deposit amount, so I got to put that in. But I'll probably write the contract without it.
Yeah.
Due diligence, it says 45 days for due diligence, and that's for us to look at the documents, the rent rolls, inspect the properties. I personally kind of just, you know, we've been in real estate long enough that you can go to house and see any red flags. I go in every single property, and I look for red flags myself, and I ask for repairs. I never did formal inspections. Plus, the bank was going to do those with the appraisals anyway. And I knew that they were FHA style.
Right.
Plus, I had a property management company. Yeah. It's like,
what are some of your red flags?
So if you see, like, you know, if there's like a lot of water near water heaters, if the roof is, you know, actively leaking, like I'm looking for major items.
Yeah, you're not cherry picking all these.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, it's a rental property. Yeah. You know, when that tenant moves out, you're doing carpets, paint, and upgrades, cleaning out the house anyway.
Yeah.
So depending on the property.
Yeah.
But other things would be like brick, or if the the exterior of the property is falling apart.
Mm-hmm.
That's something I asked for. The way I did this deal, like cradle to grave on this deal, I did it just like I knew how to do it on a residential transaction. Mm-hmm. I did it like I was buying this property with a client.
Mm-hmm.
And I followed those steps exactly, and it saved me a ton of money.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It saved me a ton of money. So due diligence, 45 days. Again, that's for you to see everything. Closing, 25 days after due diligence. But usually I'll just say, hey, once title's in. Because again, I'm going to fly out there, drive out there, whatever. Yeah. Check all the properties, look at the rent roll, interview a couple property managers, and then we can close once title's
in. So this one was, you said, was 76 or 71?
70, the one in Pittsburgh?
Yeah.
71, 70 properties and like
76. So almost,
tons of units in
there. Okay, so, all right, so then are you looking at all of these? Or are you
those properties I went in every single
one. You went to every single one, and do you recommend that?
Yeah, don't do it the way I did it.
don't do it the way he does it, but do it.
It was 30, I did like 36 hours straight. I think we were sleeping like 2 hours a night, and then writing up reports for each property to ask for, you know, and of course as a commercial listing agent, so I submit like a reply to inspection. He's like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah, what is this?
You know, he's like, we don't do this. I was like, you do now. So, you know, actually at that point, I didn't do this. I did all the inspections after we were under contract.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, to me, I was like, is this really happening? Like, is this guy really going to give me his properties for zero down? Well, they signed the contract. So I was like,
wow.
I was in Pittsburgh the next day. Everybody told me, oh, you're crazy. This is never going to happen.
Let me ask you a question. So after they contact you back, say, yeah, we'll mess with you on this.
Mm-hmm.
Is that when you went out and actively searched for partners, searched for Carl, or is this...
Yeah, I didn't have anything in place.
You didn't have anything.
Zero
clue. You had nothing going on.
I had no idea.
And then you just figured it out.
I didn't know how much money I needed. I didn't know who was doing the financing.
Damn.
I didn't know if my title... I didn't know if my own title company would do the work.
Damn.
I didn't know shit.
See that, man? That's what I'm talking about.
I didn't know shit. And actually, this is where opportunity comes into play, because Carl, like, best example in this deal is Carl just happened to message me on Instagram to buy a duplex and tell me he had 30 grand to put down the same day that I needed to pay for the appraisals on the Pittsburgh deal. And I was dead. Like, I was like, I fucking don't have the money. I'm not going to be able to buy this deal now. I've got everything in place. I spent all this time, you know, and at this point, you know, my feet are wet. I'm making a little bit of money every month because they were transferred to me right away.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and I had stabilized everything. We got everything to 95% occupancy. Mm-hmm. And I was like, deal's dead. Carl can't find the money. I don't have the money. And then Carl came out of the blue, and it was late at night. And I called him right away, and I was like, dude, you're an idiot. Take the $30,000. Give it to me. We're going to buy these properties. So, of course, Carl's like, damn, dude, I haven't seen you since grade school.
Right, right.
Like, he probably thought I was a lunatic.
And he just knows you as to just... You know, local real estate agent.
And at that time, Carl had started to go through, like, a lot of changes where he's reading all these books on business and buying real estate.
Good.
It just all came together.
Nice.
It was just meant to happen.
And I think that when you put yourself in situations like that, you're taking care of it.
I didn't have a choice. I called every person I've ever talked to in my entire life to find that money. Like, I was scavenging the earth for that money.
Damn.
And of course, everyone's like, you're crazy. Like, no one, you're not actually buying these properties.
They already considered the deal dead.
Carl and I laugh because a lot of his, you know, everyone wants to be an investor now. Yeah. So there's a lot of cops that he works with that always shoot, like, mess with him or other business owners. And they'll be like, yeah, okay, dude, I'm sure you're really making money on this. I'm sure it's a real deal.
Yeah.
And we, you know, Carl's going to start, every month we're going to just start sending people screenshots in the bank account.
Nice.
There you go. There you go.
We're doing it the Ty Lopez way around here.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, all right. So this is awesome because, all right, now, shit, you're in this deal. You can't believe it. You can't believe it.
Can't believe it.
I don't think, I really think that too.
Yeah.
I don't think, because
I still can't.
You were just writing notes on this deal, and I don't think it really hit you yet that you own.
No.
Yeah.
No, and then there's like so many details that
I'm
going to miss.
Yeah.
You know? But there's so many things that went into this, and like the negotiation things I learned and how to handle people.
Oh, man, I was. I mean, listen, man, this is going to be crazy. This right here, we could literally package this up and sell it to people that want to invest.
Because, sell it,
you know, but we don't want to give it to you this way, and however which way we give it to you, and you're watching Get Uncomfortable podcast show with Stacy and Joe right now, and we're going to take a small break, and we'll be right back, man. Stay tuned